So the stuff that we develop is under subject stuff. So anything in this particular cyber planet is grade 4 related web activities related to the curriculum. So inside, what we've done here is we've divided them up by subject areas. And then inside, we've actually gone through and found specific stuff for our core unit. So in grade 4, this is what they need to learn. So we've got resources for each one of these different units. And then we have some general grade 4 social studies web activities. And again, teachers can add their own resources in here. It's very, very simple. Under designer options, they just click add page or tool. They can add any of these things, and you can put in your own quizzes, assignments, things like that. And a URL is a link to a website if you wanted to share a website with your students.
Yeah.
If you put in quizzes, it'll correct them for you, unless it's an essay type of thing, then you'd have to go in. A lot of teachers use the email for journaling purposes, and they can respond to the students via email, and they really like that from the other ones. So the students will log in, and actually prior to starting one of our courses, I should mention that all the students have to go through a prep course, and it's a really short course, takes about an hour of their time, and what it does is it goes through what they need to know to be able to take an online course, and then kind of weeds out the students that maybe aren't going to succeed in an online course if they're not motivated or they don't have the technical skills. They don't make it through the course, or if they're not interested, they won't go through it, and that weeds out the students that come into our courses. So they do that first, and then they're able to log into their course. And what we've started up here is at the top of each one of our courses, we have a RSS feed that we put our announcements in. And so last week, we upgraded our server, so we just put an announcement. How do you get to all this stuff?
Yeah, and I've run out of paper when we get to the important bit.
You need some paper?
On my card, there's a couple of neat.
Yeah.
The front's got our website address, which is this one.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to register for anything that we talked about today, you click on registration. Cyber Planets are here.
So could you register for the PD?
Yes. I'll show you how to do it all. So you just click I agree. Basically, you're saying I'll be appropriate online. And you put in your info. If you want a Cyber Planet for grade 2, you click there, etc., etc. And then we ask that you put in your class list, so your student's first name and last names, and a password. If you don't put a password in, we'll create one for your students. And then we send you your class list, and they can all log in, and then you have access to your Cyber Planet that way.
Just as a teaching tool.
Yep.
Sorry.
Okay. What we've tried to do inside of our courses is have, when there's a discussion that's going to be required, or a journal entry, or something like that, we put in something that's very visible for students, so they know that if they see this box, they have to do a discussion. They'll have some that say links, some that say assignments, some that say quizzes, that kind of thing. So they know that something needs to be done before they move on. So this is just a review, and then Ryan asks them to do a discussion. So they would then go to the discussion board and grade 4. Now, how we store all of our resources is through a blog system. So this is a link to a blog. And in our Cyber Planets, we don't have a lot of description of the sites, but all of these are directly related to cells and systems. So what we've tried to find are specific resources that you go to that would complement the curriculum. So,
do you have to be a system to monitor the sites in case they close down or change?
Yes, part of the other registrar's job is to go through them once a month.
Okay.
And then you can also add a new link if you want. If you find something you want to add, you can put it in there. It comes to us and we add it to the list, or we go through it and decide where it should go or if it fits in.
So you control that.
Yeah.
People can't just.
No. They can put in, like, and it'll come to us, and it's no good, we don't put it out there. So, and also you can subscribe to it, so any time you put something new in, you can access it, or it'll send you an email showing you what we added. So it's very specific. This is again grade 4 cells and systems. And we update these quite often whenever we get resources. Unfortunately, I'm a little bit behind right now because I'm trying to maintain all of this by myself. But you'll see there's all sorts of resources and tons of stuff. So that's how most of the subject areas work. I'll show you what the computer course looks like. Now, this is the course that I wrote, and it's designed to teach the students the technical part of all of these things, and then you can go ahead and integrate whatever you're teaching in the classroom for. So, for instance, I did this unit for this weather project. My students came in and I taught them how to use search engines. And by doing this unit, they learned how to search for keywords and stuff, and then they actually created a blog for their weather project. So they had a city in the world where they had to research the weather. So by using this unit, they learned how to search and evaluate websites. So then they could go ahead and find the information they needed about their city. So it's very basic in grade 4. Just a little blurb, and then there's a movie. And it's me yapping. So I'll turn it down.
Websites.
Anyways, so they can go as fast as they want, and usually at the end of each one, they have an activity that they can go ahead and do. So they can go as fast as they want through it all.
My biggest role that I spend most of my time doing is exploring the new technologies that are out there and trying to make sure that we are always on the cutting edge of the material that's out there to make things better. And so I spend a lot of my day surfing the World Wide Web, on Twitter, on Facebook, on a lot of the different social networking tools out there, and try and figure out what sort of tools are coming down the pipes that will make cyber school better. So in the last 2 years, that's what I've been spending most of my time with. Before that, I spent most of my time helping the teachers get up to speed with our courses and putting our courses at the level that will always be as technologically advanced as they can possibly be. I found that at the beginning, what we tried to do is we tried to create courses that were just a digital representation of what we do in our face-to-face schools. And since then, what we've tried to do is go past that to integrate the World Wide Web a little bit more and some of the technological tools that we have out there. A cyber school that just recreates what we do in the face-to-face classroom is missing a lot of the cool materials that are available to you on the World Wide Web and all the resources that are out there. In our face-to-face classrooms, what we tend to do is as a teacher, we use our textbook and our brain as the two resources that we use, and a cyber school class should use the internet, the teacher, and obviously the digital textbook or the learning management course that has been written. So
it's just like a face-to-face classroom in a lot of ways. Unless you spell it out for some of these kids, they'll never find it. So that's why the instructions have to be really clear on a lot of these things, because you have kids that are, like I said, across the spectrum, and you know, you find out where your course is lacking really quickly, because when you get the same questions from the same area, obviously, you know, as the designer, I didn't explain something well enough, or you know, you're always tweaking your course. You're always finding something new you can add, and some new video or something like that. I was just going to say, these courses are just dynamic. You're never done developing them.
No.
It's a constant thing.
So only open to students in your district?
No, our courses are open to anyone. Anyone who wants to register.
So globally, anyone?
Globally.
But they'd have to pay a fee?
They pay a tuition fee, yes.
Or even any of us could look at accessing it.
Absolutely.
Now, yes, and if you were wanting to...
One in a cyber school. Like, we have a very substantial waiting list of teachers who would like to get their foot in the door in any way, shape, or form. So... we have that pool to draw from.
So Ryan, do they come from schools all over the district here? I mean, do you have to look at that as far as a time frame of when they can fit into here, or can they do that
anytime? One of the biggest things too, because like Darren said, you're taking the strongest, best teachers, and that doesn't make us very popular with other administrators at times, because we're pulling some senior teachers out of some other areas, but you know, in the long run, it strengthens a cyber school.
You're not pulling them. Oh,
no.
We're
taking a bit of them, but again, just taking a little bit of some of the best teachers creates scheduling issues. Somebody has to come in and teach that one class that we pulled that teacher away from. So, in that regard, I know that, you know, Darren has to fight sometimes to get what he feels is the best situation for cyber school, but.
So does Darren do the selection and appointment of staff or the district?
A little bit of both. This year, actually, because of the influx of students, what we did was put together a survey and invited all teachers in our school division to participate. And it kind of went through why they might want to be a cyber school teacher, asking them questions that might give us a good idea of if they could be a good online teacher, and what subject areas they like to teach, what grades, and that kind of thing. Got 90 teachers.
It was an open house too.
Yeah,
like there was
really
90 teachers who had applied, and we had an open house, and Darren spoke about the cyber school experience and what it's all about. And from that pool,
we choose our teachers from that pool
teachers.
If possible now, because you know they're interested.
Yes,
and, you know, he's able to have a few people to choose from, so that if their administrator says no, and then he has somebody else to go to. It's tough. It's always
a balancing
tough.
Act.
We have one teacher here who wanted to be full time. He's got so many courses and so many students, and he's such a good face to face teacher that the administrators can't have him full time.
Right.
So that's good too, because we know we have amazing teachers on our staff.
Mine is called I Love Smart Boards. What I have on here are resources and my in services that I run for engaging students with smart boards, and I find lots of great resources and I post them in here. And then we do have a smart board learning community that they eventually make their way from here into the learning community. So you can subscribe to this as well.
Have you guys used smart boards, or is that a big push at all?
Yeah, a big push. Yeah, a lot of them in schools.
So as for instance, the introduction to smart board course that I have in that PD lounge, before I'll go out and do an engaging students in service, I ask the teachers to go through that so that I don't have to go there and show them how to use the pens and all that first, so we can actually get into the integration part. So,
okay. I'm going to show you another neat thing that we've developed here through Cyber School. Because we're an online school, we think it's really important to have some sort of social gathering for students. So what we've done is we've started up a student lounge so that all students who join Cyber School have access to the student lounge. And this is a place that Ryan takes care of. And there's lots of, the students can communicate with each other. We put up contests in here. Students have questions about courses. This is their first place they'll go and ask. Somebody will answer them right away, usually. So there's tons of communication that goes on in here.
It's the area where we try to create community in cyber school, because in an online world, you can have students from all over the place, and they never really get a chance to interact with each other like you would in a face-to-face. This area allows them to talk to anybody who's enrolled in cyber school. So, you know, here in the discussion board, since it's asynchronous, there isn't really any time that a student has to be on, but they can leave postings, and it's a really good communication tool between students of cyber school who may never ever see each other, but can develop, you know, relationships with other students in the cyber school. And again, it's a safe environment. Outsiders do not have access to this. They need a password, they need a username. So I'm constantly moderating this. Students who are inappropriate, or postings that are inappropriate, I take off immediately and I contact the student. It's not really an issue though. They know that it's moderated because I'm actively adding postings.
Right.
So they know that I'm reading it. So it really, I think last year I might have had to remove 3 postings, maybe. And that was over a course of a year. We can have thousands of postings a year.
Yeah.
And it's a really safe
yeah.
environment.
We also like to survey students about a lot of different things going on in the world. For instance, when we had our election last year, we posted some questions in the student lounge. Students give us their input on what they, you know, their opinions about different things. So it's a good way for us to communicate with our students. All of our staff have access to this. They're not required to go in, but most of them do just because it's a good way to socialize with our students.
Okay.
So this has been very active and very successful. We used to have students that would organize bowling and all sorts of different things, and they'd actually get together outside of the school.
If you scroll down too, what I try to do is, on the homepage.
Yeah.
You try to create an environment too that's a little bit fun too. So there's polls. I don't know where the, oh, there they are. There they come in. And since this is, like, my role here is a guidance counselor, so students who are needing help, like, socially or just questions that you would ask a regular guidance counselor, this is the area where they can ask me, and I try to help them. Primarily, it's academic, kids who want to sign up and don't know which classes they need to get their grade 12. But every once in a while, I get students who are cyber school kids who just need to talk or vent. And we have students from all over the world, and especially like within Saskatoon, and I'm finding more and more that students are, they find it easier to email me than it would be to talk face-to-face to their own school guidance counselor, just because of the reality of email. You know, it's easy, and I think it's, in a lot of ways, it's a little less personal, so that'll gives them the freedom to express themselves maybe a little bit easier than it would be to have a face-to-face with somebody. So more and more I'm getting students from other schools who are just saying, you know, I just need to talk to somebody about this, and then they'll, you know, just email me. We have a chance for them to use Skype too. I have a Skype account, and they can video chat if they would like. Hardly ever happens, but the opportunity is there if they want to. So yeah, and the kids' help phone, it's our, you know, it's Canada's online source for help too. So even if a student isn't even comfortable talking with me, they have the option here to go to other sources for help.
Ryan, what if a student is fully enrolled here, so doing, you know, majority of courses through this?
We have educator resource info as well, some web resources and tutorials. And then we also have links to all of the in-services we do. So if you want PowerPoints about anything that we do here, you can access them here. We try to post everything we do at conferences. Darren has been to Australia in 2002. That. And then Darren and I each have our own blogs. So under blog info, Darren's is TADO. So this is all his resources that he finds, and we post videos and we post PowerPoints. And
at some point, we're going to be breaking everything up that we did today into like 1 or 2 minute videos.
And they'll all be right.
They'll all be here.
Here.
So you have a lot of time in your hands, then.
So Darren's, this is more of an administrative blog. This is the kind of stuff you
post. We were told a lot of your staff could be 3/4 of their time face-to-face and 1/4 of the time here in the cyber school. So what?
Yes.
Does that present a problem then for the consistency of what your expectations are for staff here when the majority of their time would be in a school-based setting?
Yeah, the when we first started, that was a plan because we thought it would be the best way to sell Cyber School is to actually have the spokesperson within the face-to-face school as well. And so when we started off to have, obviously it would be easier to have a full-time staff like Kelly and like Ryan that I see 90% of every single day. I can just walk out of my office and say, hey, you guys, here's what I think we should be working on. Here's where I think we should be going. The teachers who are teaching face-to-face don't come to the Cyber School. So any communication that I have with them is done this way or is done by text documents or emails or something like that. So the communication that we lost through the design where they're in the face-to-face school was a conscious thing that we did on purpose because that those all the teachers that we've chosen the first couple of years of the Cyber School, we chose the experienced teacher who was well-respected within their own buildings. What we didn't do in the Cyber School, and this is part of our administrative structure in our face-to-face vision, was that they chose very experienced teachers who were not the teachers that were